4, verse 8. Listen as I read. Our help is in the name of the Lord, who made heaven and earth. Amen? Amen. Father, indeed, our help only comes from you and no one else. We trust in no one and no institution but you, because we know it is you who is the great creator, who by just speaking your words, you made heaven and earth, and you made us to occupy and dwell and live on this earth. Today, we call you, come back quickly, Lord. It is our desire to see you face to face and to be with you as you are our God and we your King, and you our King. Please, Lord, help us. Help us to persevere until the end of your coming. This we pray in your precious and magnificent name. Amen.
The son of Shaphan,
whom the king of Babylon has appointed over the cities of Judah, and stay with him among the people, or else go anywhere it seems right for you to go. So the captain of the bodyguard gave him a ration and a gift and let him go. Then Jeremiah went to Mizpah to Gedaliah, the son of Ahikam, and stayed with him among the people who were left in the land. Now all the commanders of the forces that were in the field, they and their men, heard that the king of Babylon had appointed Gedaliah, the son of Ahikam, over the land, and that he put him in charge of the men, women, children, those of the poorest of the land who had not been exiled to Babylon. So they came to Gedaliah at Mizpah, along with Ishmael, the son of Nethaniah, and Jehonan, and Jonathan, the sons of Kareah, and Sariah, the son of Tanhumeth, and the sons of Aphiah, the Nephatite, and Jezaniah, the son of Makaphite, both they and their men. Then Gedaliah, the son of Ahikam, the son of Shaphan, swore to them and to their men, saying, "Do not be afraid of serving the Chaldeans. Stay in the land and serve the king of Babylon, that it may go well with you. Now as for me, behold, I am going to stay in Mizpah to stand for you before the Chaldeans who come to us. But as for you, gather in wine and summer fruit and oil and put them in your storage vessels and live in your cities that you have taken over. Likewise, also to the Jews who were in Moab and among the sons of Ammon and in Edom and who were in all the other countries, heard that the king of Babylon had left a remnant for Judah and that he had appointed over them Gedaliah the son of Ahikam, the son of Shaphan. Then all the Jews returned from all the places to which they had been driven away and came to the land of Judah, to Gedaliah as Mizpah, and gathered in wine and summer fruit in great abundance. Now, Jehonan, the son of Kareah, and all the commanders of the forces that were in the field came to Gedaliah at Mizpah and said to him, "Are you well aware that Baalis, the king of the son of Ammon, has sent Ishmael, the son of Nethaniah, to take your life?" But Gedaliah, the son of Ahikam, did not believe them. Then Jehonan, the son of Kareah, spoke secretly to Gedaliah and Mizpah, saying, "Let me go and kill Ishmael, the son of Nethaniah, and not a man will know. Why should he take your life, so that all the Jews who were gathered to you would be scattered and the remnant of Judah will perish?" But Gedaliah, the son of Ahikam, said to Jehonan, "The son of Kareah, do not do this thing, for you are telling a lie about Ishmael." This is the word of the Lord. You may be seated. Well, as we look at this text here, it is a bleak picture, a very bleak picture. Because once what we saw was that the people of God was living in his place, under his rule, and enjoying his blessings. You remember when Abraham was called and God blessed him? And then he passed that blessing on to his son Isaac? And then Isaac passed that down to Jacob? And then Jacob blessed his son Judah. Well, what's left of Judah in this particular aftermath looks like what we encountered when we see on the news, the wildfires and tornadoes that have torn down and just devastated whole of cities. Everything has been reduced to ashes. Only a few, and at that, the most destitute people are roaming about. But what's left, they will inherit. Now, the royal family are dead. All the noble people, the artisans, they're also dead. They've been carried away into exile. The city of Jerusalem stands totally destroyed. Its temple, the king's house, have all been looted and burned down. And the only thing remaining are these utterly poor and unimportant people. But even now, there's still promise. Do you remember back in Genesis 49, when we were told that the scepter shall not depart from Judah, nor the ruler's staff from between his feet until Shiloh comes? And to him shall be the obedience of the people. That's a promise that will not go empty. Now, who would have thought after that promise that Judah would have fallen so far and so hard? Well, it's happened because the people haven't listened. In fact, look at what we see next in verse 2 and 3. Here we find Jeremiah apparently being caught up in exile, but as soon as he's recognized by Nebuchadnezzar, the captain of the king of Nebuchadnezzar's bodyguard, he lets him go and have his way to either come with him back or to stay in this land. But what's more important is look at Nebuchadnezzar's, as he explains with great accuracy why and what has happened to Judah. Why have they experienced this calamity? In verses 2 and 3, it says, "Now the captain of the bodyguard had taken Jeremiah and said to him, 'The Lord your God promised this calamity against this place. And the Lord has brought it on and done just that he has promised, because you people sinned against the Lord and did not listen to his voice. Therefore, this thing has happened to you.'" Now, how is it that Nebuchadnezzar has come to know this? Is it possible he's heard one of Jeremiah's sermon on the judgment of God that the people should not listen? Now, not much is said or even known about Nebuchadnezzar, but we know in Jeremiah 52, it'll be discovered that he's the one who actually goes in with his men who will burn down the temple, the king's houses, and all the homes in Jerusalem. But after listening to him, don't you get a sense that perhaps he's a believer? He understands when God promises to do something, he will. He understands the consequences of sin against an almighty God. He also understands provoking God leads to destruction. If only the people of Judah would have understood this, they wouldn't be in this situation today. And the sign that they don't understand this is found in the remaining portion of our text that I'm going to get to quickly. Here we see there's an actual assassination plot against Gedaliah, who's been left in charge by King Nebuchadnezzar. And he's been left in charge over the poorest of people who are inconsequential and have been left behind. And of course, in the next chapter that we read, we're going to see and witness some of the most dumbest decisions ever made by this remnant, who was once a blessed and mighty people of God who had fallen so far. These few remaining people, as we'll see, because of how they end up, are not the true remnant. Those remnants have been carried away into exile into Babylon, by which the promised Messiah, the Lion of the tribe of Judah, will come through. So, brothers and sisters, here's what I want you to take note of. God still judges nations, and no nation is immune from his judgment. In fact, all nations are already lost. Even ours. But so long as the church is busy and at work about doing God's job, which is reaching the lost, individuals from all the nations of the earth can be and will be saved.
Amen.
The only remedy, of course, is the gospel. Yes. Nebuchadnezzar was absolutely correct. Again, let's remember his words that he proclaimed to Jeremiah. The Lord your God promises calamity against this place, and the Lord has brought it on and done just as he's promised. because you people sinned against the Lord and did not listen to his voice. Therefore, this thing has happened to you. Let's remain in the grace and favor of our God by being faithful and obedient to him, even when others aren't. Yes. Let's proclaim the gospel in its entirety. Amen?
Amen.
This is the word of the Lord.
Thank you, Lord.
Father, you are the unchanging one. As you were just in your dealings with the nation of Israel, and as you were just, Father, in your dealings with Babylon, so you are just in your dealings with nations today. And as, Father, you were just in your dealings with Adam, so you are just in your dealings with us.
Thank you, Lord.
But Father, you are also merciful. If you were only just, we would have no hope. But you are just and you are merciful. You are gracious, Father. And so we find our hope in Jesus. And we thank you that there is redemption for those who will bow the knee to the Lord Jesus Christ. There is redemption for those who will turn from their sin and trust in the Savior that you have provided. We thank you, Father, for that. We thank you that your remnant, even though they were going through this tribulation, had the promise that you would preserve them.
Yes.
And we today, Father, as we endure tribulation in our own time, in our own nation, in our own lives, have your promise that you will preserve us. You will bring us home to be with you.
Yes.
Nothing can separate us from the love of Christ.
Yes.
And you will never leave us or forsake us. Thank you, Father, for these things. Forgive us for forgetting them. But Father, may they be the source of great comfort to us as we look at what's happening in the world. And we see the chaos and the tribulation around us, Father. May we think upon the wonderful promises of your word and rejoice. In Jesus' name we ask it. Amen.
Amen.
Please turn with me to Psalm 101 this morning. Psalm 101, a psalm of David. I will sing of the loving kindness and justice to you, O Lord. I will sing praises. I will give heed to the blameless way. When will you come to me? I will walk within my house in the integrity of my heart. I will set no worthless thing before my eyes. I hate the work of those who fall away. It shall not fasten its grips on me. A perverse heart shall depart from me. I will know no evil. Whoever secretly slanders his neighbor, him I will destroy. No one who has a haughty look and an arrogant heart will I endure. My eyes shall be upon the faithful of the land, that they may dwell with me. He who walks in a blameless way is the one who will minister to me. He who practices deceit shall not dwell within my house. He who speaks falsehood shall not maintain his position before me. Every morning I will destroy all the wicked of the land, so as to cut off from the city of the Lord all those who do iniquity. Father, these words of David reflect his heart. He did not always live up to them, but at his core, he was a man who knew righteousness and who pursued righteousness rather than iniquity. He was someone who knew your heart, O Lord. He knew your heart and he desired to promote holiness. And he would not tolerate sin. Again, Father, we see ourselves in your word so clearly because our hearts are here as well if we are in Christ. And yet, like David, Father, we are so inconsistent. We declare that which we know to be evil, even as we entertain it in our own hearts. And so, Father, we recognize our need for your grace. But, Father, if we were to only proclaim those things to be true, which are true in our own lives, we would have our mouths stopped. Rather, we with David, Father, will sing of loving kindness and justice. And we will, Father, proclaim the blameless way, though all too often we drift to the right or to the left. But Father, cause us to have this kind of a heart to love and pursue righteousness as imperfectly as we might do that. And give us hearts, Father, which hate sin, which hate injustice, which hate wickedness. We pray, Father, for those who do iniquity, that you would turn them from their way. For the end of that way is only judgment. But should they turn, Father, should they see Jesus for who he is, should they cast themselves upon him, Father, there is grace, there is mercy, there is redemption. We thank you, Father, that your church is comprised of those who have found that mercy. And we are pursuing righteousness and justice, imperfect though we be. We know that one day, Father, we will be with you, and at that point, sin will no longer be an issue. You will have dealt with wickedness fully and finally. And we will be like your Son. Bring that day about, Father. May it come quickly. Father, we pray for your people. You have given us a great privilege of interceding for one another, and so we do this day. As we know that there are those who are struggling, those who would love to be with us but can't. Father, we think of our sister Ruth Cox this morning. Pray, Father, that you would bless her, that you would ease the discomfort of her body, and continue, Father, to draw her close to you. She loves you, Father, and she loves your word, and we miss her. Father, we thank you for Barbara Demeter. Pray, Father, that she would heal quickly from the procedure which she has undergone this week. We are grateful that it went well. Bring her back to us as well. Father, we pray for Darlene and John today as their sons come home to come and visit Muriel. We pray, Father, there would be a wonderful time together as that their family is reunited. Father, accomplish good things today, we ask. Father, we pray for other families in our church. We know that there are families that are struggling. There are marriages that are under strain. Father, there are children who are in rebellion. Those who are not walking with Christ seem to have no desire to. Father, we pray that you would intervene, that you would bring to conviction those who are drifting. That if they are yours, Father, you would draw them back. And if they are not, Father, help them to seek Christ. Open their hearts and change their hearts and draw them to the Savior. We pray for our church, Father, that you would protect us. Father, there is so much error in the wider church, yet you have preserved us over so many years, and we pray that that would continue.
Yes.
Ground us evermore, Father, in your word, that we might serve you as you have commanded us to do so. Mm-hmm. Unite us, Father, in love for one another. We pray for next week as we gather here together to worship once more, and as we gather together for fellowship afterwards. Father, make it a great day in which we glorify you for all that you are. We thank you, Father, for all these things. You are so good. Send your gospel so that others might know your goodness. Pray, Father, that your gospel would go forth into this world and that you might use it to save those whom you have chosen from before the foundation of the world. Build your church, Father, we ask it. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Let's stand together and tell Jesus we love him. Hymn 72.
Joy that we come to listen to your word. of our minds to receive it, so that upon receiving it, we might grow and be faithful citizens of the kingdom of God, showing your love to this world and preaching the gospel to them, so that they might also come to be worshipers of God. This we pray, amen.
Amen.
Well, please take your Bibles and turn once again to the Gospel of Luke. The Gospel of Luke, we have for some time now been making our way through this particular Gospel, and we come to Luke chapter 19 this morning. We're going to pick up with verse 41. We're just going to be looking at a few verses this morning, verses 41 through 44. Jesus, as you know, has been making his way to Jerusalem for quite some time. This journey began within the Gospel of Luke back in chapter 9. So he's just entering into the city. Last week we saw in the previous passage his triumphal entry. This morning we pick up with verse 41. Says, when he approached Jerusalem, he saw the city and wept over it, saying, if you had known in this day, even you, the things which make for peace, but now they have been hidden from your eyes. For the days will come upon you when your enemies will throw up a barricade against you and surround you and hem you in on every side. And they will level you to the ground, and your children within you, and they will not leave in you one stone upon another, because you did not recognize the time of your visitation. Father, speak to us now through your word, for Christ's sake. Amen. Well, our passage might sound familiar, given what we've been seeing in Jeremiah. Because in Jeremiah, of course, Babylon has been brought down against Judah, and the city of Jerusalem has been destroyed. And here, as we listen to the words of Jesus, he's telling the city that once again, it will be destroyed. There are centuries that have passed in that interval. And yet, God is bringing judgment once again. The passage that we're looking at this morning begins with this phrase, when he approached Jerusalem. The one approaching Jerusalem, of course, is Jesus. And as he came into view of the city, we are told that he wept. This one who approached Jerusalem, this one who wept, was and is not only the man Jesus, but he is the incarnate Son of God. He is God become man with all that it means to take on essential humanity. Now, note that I said essential humanity. We know and we understand that there's one very obvious difference, which Jesus does not share with the rest of humanity, and that is, of course, sin. But sin is not an essential part of humanity. Humanity was created without sin in the garden. And there's coming a day when humanity, redeemed humanity, will again exist without sin. So sin is not an essential part of who we are. But in regard to essential humanity, Jesus became as we are in his incarnation. He was, Scripture tells us, a man of sorrow and acquainted with grief. He would not be sheltered from the grief of this world. He would be a true man in our humble condition. So the eternal God was formed in the womb of the Virgin Mary. He grew up through childhood, through adolescence, into manhood. He had a human brain and the human means of acquiring and retaining knowledge and learning from it. He had human emotions. He had functioning tear ducts. And when he cried, he had to dry his eyes and he needed to wipe his nose. He was not a stoic. He was touched by the griefs and the infirmities of his friends. He is our sympathetic high priest. He is our sympathetic fellow sufferer. He looked forward to meals with his friends. He asked them to pray for him when he was cast down. Jesus had an inner life which included emotion, and he was not afraid to expose that to us. He told his friends, "My soul is troubled." Before the crucifixion, he acknowledged, "My soul is very sorrowful, even unto death." He wept in grief at the death of his friend Lazarus and Lazarus's sisters as they grieved. He prayed, but he did not just repeat rote prayer. We are told that he offered up prayer and supplication with loud cries and tears to him who was able to save him from death. Hebrews 5:7. So we're being told through the life of Jesus, who came to us for one purpose, to reveal the Father, we're being told through Jesus what the Father is like as well. God, the Father, is compassionate. He is as involved in our lives as Jesus. The heart of the Christian gospel is the picture of a God who loves. A God who loves people. A love that wants us. He's got to have us. It is not merely that all good gifts are sent from heaven above. There is a dynamic and saving love with God that moved him to seek for his people. Billions of us. And to find us. And to hold us, to never let us go. It is a love that is not satisfied until all that he has chosen to set his love upon have come to receive that love. And having poured that love out upon us, it will never leave us again. That's the love of God. He pities us, yes, but more than that, he acts upon that pity and relieves us of our misery. He has made up his mind and will to do it. And in Christ, that work is done and finished. This is why he has come to Jerusalem. So here in our passage, Luke tells us that when his long journey to Jerusalem was complete, and he stood on a hilltop to see lying before him this magnificent city, he wept over it. He grieved over it. And that grief was not only the grief of his humanity, it was the grief of his incarnate deity. In our text, we see both God and man filled with sadness at the sight of the city and its Jesus, the God-man, looked upon Jerusalem with grief. We too ought to look upon our towns and cities and states and nation and world and grieve. We ought to see the place that we call home in all of its confusion and need and rebellion and grieve. Because to do so is to reflect the heart of Jesus. In this sense, every Christian ought to be characterized by sorrow and acquainted with grief. But there was something unique about this grieving one, of course, and there is something unique about the city over which he grieved. And we must ask the question then, when God came for a visit, why did he weep? Why is it that Jesus wept over this city? And in our passage this morning, Luke is going to give us three reasons to explain why Jesus wept. And the first is this. You see it there in verse 42. He wept because the people of Jerusalem were ignorant of their need. And what they needed were things that make for peace. If you had known in this day, even you, the things which make for peace. The Lord Jesus knew Jerusalem well. He had lived 30 years in Nazareth, 70 miles north of Jerusalem, a few days' journey for a pilgrim. Three times a year, throughout his entire life, he and his family would go and spend a week in Jerusalem at the feasts. And so in 100 visits to Jerusalem, Christ had gotten to know the city and its people well. During his public ministry, many of the people of Jerusalem had gone out to hear him and to witness his miraculous healing. They had heard his great claims. Before Abraham was, I am. I and my Father are one. I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father but by me. They had heard his great gospel promises in which he declared himself to be the focal point of salvation. For God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, that whoever believes in him might not perish but have eternal life. They heard him say, "Come to me, all you who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls, for my yoke is easy and my burden is light." And yet, though they knew, they did not know. Though they listened and saw, and though they surely spent much time discussing these things, they did not know Jesus. They did not give themselves to him. And Jesus knew this. He knew that they had not. Jesus was confronted then with a city whom he loved, but whose people didn't want him as their Lord. They had heard so much, they had seen the most extraordinary things that anybody living on this planet had ever seen or heard, but they were not satisfied. They couldn't say, "Now, if someone would come back from the dead, I believe," because he had raised at least 3 people that we know of, and they still didn't believe. And Jesus wept. He wept and he said, "If you had known that in this day, even you, the things which make for peace." It's all a quest for peace, isn't it? The drugs, the drunkenness, the serial relationships, the pornography, the quest for money, the pursuit of power. It's all a quest for peace. I don't have it. Maybe this will be the way to obtain it. But there is no peace for the wicked. Augustine wrote in his Confessions that God has made us for himself and our hearts are restless until they find their rest in him. God had sent his Son into the world as the one mediator between him and us. He came into the world to show us the living God and to live the life that we should live but cannot. He took on humanity so he could be our mediator, our representative, our substitute. He became the Lamb of God. And he made atonement for our guilt through his death on the cross. He died in our place. God dealt with him as we ourselves deserve to be dealt with. And as we shall be dealt with if we reject the one whom the Father has sent. If we reject him as our mediator and as our substitute, we will pay our own price for sin. But through the life and death of the Lord Jesus Christ, there can be forgiveness for our sin. We receive mercy from God because Jesus has received justice from God. He is our substitute. It was justice, not for his own sin, for he had none, but for our sin. It was our guilt for which he freely bore the penalty in his own body on the cross. Judgment for Jesus, pardon for us, if we would but trust in him. This is God's way of peace. It is a costly way. But the bill is paid by God himself, and the work is done by Christ. It is costly, but it costs us nothing. It is costly, but it is a cost that the Father paid. To us, there is no cost but the cost of discipleship. The redemption itself is free. It is peace with God, which we could not and did not buy, but which Christ purchased for us. He paid the price. He bought it. It was not earned by our doings, but by the doings of Christ. How do we get this peace? We get this peace by entrusting ourselves entirely and wholly in this life to Jesus. And when we stand to give an account to God, we plead Christ and Christ alone. Forever and ever in heaven, we plead our only entitlement of being there is because of Christ. It's not by our loving that we get peace, because our love is always imperfect. It's not by our good works, because they're all mixed up with sin. It comes only through faith in Christ, apart from any work that we think we have to offer. There is no other way. It's not baptism. It's not some kind of confirmation. It's not by a man in a robe putting his hands upon our heads. It's not by communion. It's not by church membership. It is only and ever through the Lord Jesus Christ and what he has done by his righteous life and his atoning death. And all we do is say, yes, I trust Christ. I trust Jesus. Paul put it this way. Therefore, since we have been justified by faith, we have peace with God through the Lord Jesus Christ. What makes for peace? Jesus makes for peace. This is God's way. Perfect peace comes through trusting in the Lord Jesus Christ. And once you place your trust in Christ alone, that peace is yours. We who have trusted Christ have peace because God is not angry with us. We have peace because we have no fear of death and hell. We have peace because God promised that he will never leave us or forsake us. We have peace because he has promised to supply all that we need. We have peace because when we walk through the valley of the shadow of death, he has promised to be there with us. We have peace because an angry God has become a loving Father. And it is all through trusting and following and obeying Jesus Christ. This is why Christ said, come to me, all you who are weary and burdened. I will give you rest. But if you reject him, there is no peace. None of those things I've just mentioned are true for those who will reject the offer of God's grace in Jesus Christ. There is only the ceaseless trampling of one club to one bar after another, night after night. Only the endless chain of sexual partners that never satisfy. Only the constant effort to find some temporary escape in drugs or work or whatever your diversion of choice might be. But there is no peace. You will try whatever you can to fill the emptiness inside, but Augustine was right. That empty space will remain empty until it is filled with Jesus. If, like the people of Jerusalem, these things have been hidden from your eyes, then it is my fervent prayer for you today that this will be the day when your eyes will be opened to the truth. That Jesus is the Prince of Peace, and only in knowing Jesus can one know true peace. But that was not the only reason that Jesus wept as he approached Jerusalem that day. And their need of peace was not the only thing that the people of Jerusalem were ignorant of. They were also ignorant of what was to come. Verse 43 says, "For the days will come upon you when your enemies will throw up a barricade against you and surround you and hem you in on every side, and they will level you to the ground and your children within you, and they will not leave in you one stone upon another." They were ignorant of what was to come, and what was to come was destruction. And from the time of the Tower of Babel, man has always attempted to bring heaven down to earth. Because man is created in the image of God, and because there are certain truths which we know intrinsically, because God has placed that knowledge within us, even though we might suppress that knowledge in unrighteousness, man has always, it seems, had a vision of the restoration. Man knows there is something wrong, and has this impulse to try to make it right by himself. There's a faint, distant memory of what once was, and a blurry, unfocused hope of what one day will be. The problem, of course, comes when man attempts to usher in this utopian vision for himself. We have seen over and over again how such attempts end. In the previous century, we saw more than 100 million people killed in the attempt to bring about a Marxist or socialist utopia. Communism, Nazism, Maoism, radical Islam, the thing they all have in common is the belief that they will be the ones to create paradise on earth. One might think we would have learned by now. And yet, here we are once again, listening to voices telling us that we'll get it right the next time. There were utopias in the first century. There were visions that people had of bringing about paradise. In fact, there were many who wanted to enlist Jesus into their utopian vision. There were many who desired to make Jesus the focal point of that vision. They were very disappointed when they saw Jesus come riding along on a donkey. That was not the plan that they had. They wanted to put him on a strong white war horse. They wanted Jesus to be the Messiah king who would lead the armies of Israel against Rome and thereby usher in the restoration of the Davidic kingdom, Israel's utopia. But here's the problem. Those utopian visions only bring destruction. And Jesus wept because that was exactly what was going to happen to Jerusalem. The days will come upon you when your enemies will throw up a barricade against you and surround you and hem you in on every side, and they will level you to the ground and your children within you, and they will not leave in you one stone upon another. And this was fulfilled to the letter a generation later, in AD 70. Rome comes down against Jerusalem and lays siege to the city, putting up a barricade, surrounding, hemming them in on every side. They destroyed the walls of the city. They destroyed the temple. They leveled it to the ground. The people of Jerusalem were trapped within that siege. When you read the account of that siege of Jerusalem, written by Josephus, first century Jewish historian, it is horrifying. Your children within you. Children were slaughtered. Babies cannibalized. Because there was no food left as a result of the siege. Everything Jesus speaks of here came about exactly as he says. No bright tomorrow, no driving out the Roman armies and the Messiah reigning over Israel and the world, nothing like it. Simply the most horrific scenes and a new slavery for the people. Jerusalem no more. Pagan Rome triumphant. That's not the plan. That's not the vision. And yet that's what occurred. And we're reminded, put not your hopes in chariots, says the psalmist. Put not your hope in princes. That's what Jerusalem had done. They had put their hope in a military, in political solutions, and they were sorely disappointed. Destruction has and will come at the hands of man, but utopia will never come at the hands of man. Utopia will come only from the hand of Almighty God in His time. We call it the new creation, the new heavens and the new earth. And it's something that no human being has the power to bring about. Man cannot bring utopia, but he can bring destruction. God, however, has promised to bring both destruction and utopia. He has promised to destroy the world before he recreates it as that place in which he will dwell eternally with his people. But it's not only this world which God will one day bring to destruction, it is also the souls of men who will not bow the knee before him. They too will be destroyed. Just as Jerusalem was destroyed by their rejection of the Messiah, so too men and women will be destroyed who reject the Savior. So too will they be destroyed who place their hope in those things which cannot bring peace. So too will they be destroyed who look for utopia by means of man. So too will they be destroyed who live wasted lives pursuing only money and pleasure and ease. Friends, destruction is coming. And it's coming on both a global and a personal scale. And if you find yourself outside of Christ, that destruction is coming for you. There is but one escape, and his name is Jesus. The same Jesus who wept over Jerusalem now weeps over you. He assures us in his word that he takes no pleasure in the death of the wicked. Will you not turn and live? Will you not turn from your empty hopes and dreams of utopia? Will you not turn from your trust in political parties and philosophies and systems? Will you not turn from your endless pursuit of those things that can never bring you peace? Those things that can never bring you contentment? Will you turn from all that is not Christ? Whatever is not Christ can only bring destruction.
Mm-hmm.
And the weeping Savior now calls upon you to turn and live. And there is yet another reason for Jesus weeping. He wept because of yet one more thing of which the city was ignorant. Just as they were ignorant of what was to come, they were also ignorant of what had already come. You did not recognize the time of your visitation. God had told them that he would come. And now he had. And they did not recognize him, and they did not receive him. God had come to visit, and they slammed the door in his face. God had told them that he would come back in Genesis, when immediately following the fall, he told us that one would come who would crush the head of the serpent. Now he had come. We were told that one would come who would be a greater prophet even than Moses, and that one had now come. David told us that one was coming who would be greater than he, and who would establish his kingdom, but first he would suffer, and he would die, but his body would not be left to decay. He would be raised. Now that one has come. The prophets told us that the suffering servant would come, and he would bear our sin upon himself. By his stripes we would be healed. Now he has come. Jesus came to Israel and they did not know him and they did not receive him. Jesus came and they turned him away. Jesus came and they turned away from him. Jesus came offering peace and joy and eternal life, and they rejected him. And they spat upon him, and they beat him, and they crucified him. And Jesus comes now to you. Perhaps he has come to you many times before. Whenever you have heard the gospel, Jesus has come to you. And as I proclaim the gospel to you, Jesus is coming to you. As I stand in this pulpit proclaiming the gospel, it is the voice of Jesus that you hear in his word. And he is saying, come, turn from the vain things of this life which you have so often pursued. Come and live. Come and escape destruction. Come and I will receive you. Come and I will give you abundant life. Come and I will give you eternal life. Why would you die? Why would you waste your life on things that do not satisfy when I can give you everything? Why would you live your life in frustration and emptiness when you can have peace? Rather, come to me, Jesus says. I'm the one who makes for peace. Come to me, for I am the source of all joy. Come to me, for I am the Redeemer. Come to me, for only I can give you new life. Come to me, for only I can forgive. Come to me, for only I can rescue you from the destruction which is to come. Come to me and live forever in paradise. Come to me. Come to me. Come to me. That is Jesus' plea. He is so patient. is so long-suffering. But the day of salvation, the day of his visitation, will not last forever. Today is yet the day of salvation. Will you not come while it is still that day? Will you not come before the day of salvation turns to the day of destruction? God has come to visit. How will you respond? Father, we pray for any who have closed the door to Jesus. We pray, Father, that you would, even now, through your word, change hearts. That you would bring conviction of sin.
Yes.
And that you would create, Father, faith. Save this day, Father. And do it even for those, Father, who may be listening far into the future. May they hear your voice in your word and be saved. For Christ's sake, we ask it. Amen.
Amen.
Things of earth.
May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace.